Turbulent times are often written about in the history books, and myths and legends appear alongside them. However, at the time, many cannot really understand what's happening. They are simply going about their lives. Some are doing well, some are struggling. Life goes on. Certain statistics can foreshadow future events. Some have higher weight and correlation than others. For those who are paying attention to the data, this is truly an interesting time to be alive. You came here for the truth, so let me unveil that for you. Today we are going to talk about the drought before the flood. In some ways, you can relate this to deflation before inflation. A lot of the information that I show you is simply updates to the data, which I believe are very important alongside all of the statistics that we see on a daily basis. Maybe it's the unemployment rate, maybe it's the jobs numbers, maybe it's the stock market, and so on. Each one tells a story, but when you put it all together, you start to understand the big picture. I'm going to get into a lot of different things today. I wanted to give you some really quick updates on things that I have been talking about recently. Let's begin with the repos. Here you can see directly from the New York Fed's website, even though they've told us that this was calming down, that things were getting better, you can see that as of Monday morning, $63.5 billion, I'll show you the chart that corresponds, even though they said this is not going to be a problem after a few days of injection, well, clearly that isn't the case. We'll see what happens after October 10th if they go beyond that. However, when I look at the data, I know what I'm seeing. I'm seeing all of these repo operations, billions and billions every single day just to keep the market afloat. I've also seen that the balance sheet of the Federal Reserve has expanded, something that it hasn't done for years. This is all intentional because they need to create a crisis to have a reason in order to begin QE4, to begin the next round of monetary easing. WeWork is another topic that we have gotten into here on the channel. They have actually scrapped their IPO, and some have said that this could be the catalyst for many investors to lose faith in a lot of these different types of corporations. There are so many companies out there with their valuations sky high, and yet some feel that they should be much, much lower. I have gotten into the problems with WeWork, and we talked about this in previous videos. Won't get into that, just wanted to let you know that officially they have scrapped their IPO. The median 2019 IPO has sharply underperformed relative to history, and we have seen this occur a few times before, most notably 2009, and here it looks like 2002. You can see that also happened back in the 90s, something very interesting because we have seen time and time again where they hold these companies up on the pedestal and we are supposed to throw everything we have into them, yet time and time again, the majority of these IPOs do not turn out well. You can look at some of them like Beyond Meat, which has been absolutely insane in their performance. Yet you look at another company, Uber or Lyft, which is pervasive out there. You see Uber drivers all over the place, Uber Eats and so on. And yet the IPO itself didn't do well. So it's not necessarily translating in the real economy as it relates to what's going on with their stock. So that's all I'm going to talk about for this here. Forever 21. I had covered this recently. I found this interesting because in their file for bankruptcy, they're going to close 350 stores worldwide amid restructuring. So in the previous video I did, I mentioned 178 stores. That's for the US. It's going to be 350 stores globally, and they have 800 and change. So that is a very large percentage, and including 44 stores in Canada. So all of those Forever 21 stores you see in Canada, they are gone. I'm sure they're going to sell off all their inventory, so look for that. And that information connects in with this. Selected announced US store closures 2019, not an exhaustive list. This is only just the biggest names. And you can see on here, obviously, for example, Payless Shoes, thousands of stores being closed down, Gymboree, GNC, and so on, all down the list. On the opposite end of the spectrum, you do see, for example, dollar stores opening up like crazy. And that's not a good thing because it really shows you where the market is at. What does the person, the average consumer, want? Well, apparently they want cheaper products, and this is exactly what's going on today. Thousands of stores opening up, and yet primarily we see them being something like dollar stores instead of more higher end stores, ones that employ lots of people and bring in high revenue, but it doesn't seem to be the case. Announced completed store closures in the US over the years. I get this all the time. People are talking about how really it's nothing to worry about, or they say, well, it's e-commerce and so on. Just look at the trend. Since 2012, look at what has happened. Look, Amazon existed here. Amazon existed here. I promise you, Amazon existed here and Amazon existed here. Have the buying patterns changed over the last, let's say, year or two? Not really. I'm sure as the years go on, you're getting more people buying more things online. I get that. But to suggest that over a period of 1 or 2 years that it's making such a dramatic effect on these particular corporations, that's nonsense. On the right-hand side, announced completed store closures in the US in apparel and accessories. And of course, this happens to be one sector that has really, really taken a beating. And there's a lot of competition out there, certainly. The profit is very high. So there is no reason, in my opinion, why they can't actually improve on what they have done. It's just a matter of fact. Well, you know, we're looking at this year, 2019 Chapter 11 filings. They're up 18% year over year. And a lot of people don't realize that, but this is what has happened. It's not just in retail. Take a look. It breaks it down by section. You can see in energy and financials and industrials and so on. Even though it was very high back in 2018, this has increased yet again. We're going to see it go further. The year's not over yet. And of course, I will track that here on the channel. I want to switch gears and look at some of the data right now. The Chicago PMI, 3 out of the last 4 months, we have seen this declining. This shows you, just like back in 2015, that we are encountering a slowdown that is happening that is not largely discussed in the media. They mention it and they simply whitewash it. They just skim over the top. Okay, the PMI is down, but guess what? This stock is the one you need to buy this week. That's the way the media likes to project information to you, and unfortunately for a lot of people, they simply take it. Now, one of the most important economic indicators relates to this here, the yield curve. Okay, now we've heard about this many times before. I've covered it here on the channel. There's an argument of which is the most important. Well, personally, I don't think any of them are particularly important over the other ones. If you look at this, you see it historically, you see it from country to country. Many of them go in the exact same direction. Okay. Whether it goes below the zero or not, if it actually inverts or not, to me, it doesn't matter. It just shows you the trend. And what they suggest is that because the central banks have manipulated interest rates, they've been buying all the debt, they've been doing everything that actually has screwed it up. So this time is different. That's the only reason why we had the yield curve inversion. So you don't have anything to worry about. This time, it's a false signal. Now, you can look at this all the way back to 1968, and it shows you time and time again that we have encountered this. Okay, so we're looking at it, and it happens to be a big issue if you actually see it and measure it for yourself. But every single time that we have this event occurring, a recession follows. Okay, since 1968, every single time, this happens to be the 10 and the 3 month, but you can see it time and time again. Now, what's going to happen? How long is it going to take? That's up to you to decide. But I simply wanted to show you this because so many people are focusing on these really arbitrary indicators like the U3 unemployment rate, which is completely false when you actually look into how it's made up. Regardless, let's take a look at this next article. For the first time since 2016, companies with fragile balance sheets are outperforming their sturdier peers and the broad market, according to Goldman Sachs. That's a clear sign that rate cuts are shoring up investor confidence in heavily indebted companies, the segment of corporate America that's perhaps most at risk to any downturn that hits the US economy. How fantastic is this, that investors are buying up these type of companies, even though they are at most risk to a downturn? Fantastic. well, you know, you don't have to worry because the Federal Reserve will reduce interest rates, and apparently that's gonna fix the problem. That's gonna prolong any crisis forever and ever and ever. But you don't have to worry, even if there is a crisis, which there won't be a crisis, don't worry, the Federal Reserve said so. If there is a crisis, well, the Federal Reserve is gonna take care of it. Now, think about how ridiculous that is for a second. I mean, my goodness, the way that people are blindsided, and why? Because they got a lot of money riding on it. Obviously, they need to believe that. Just like a person going to the casino and they are hitting the slot machine and they think, if I leave this machine now, somebody's gonna come in here and they are going to win. I can't leave the machine. I need to keep playing until I am the winner. They believe that they will be the winner, yet they keep putting money in, and they stay on that machine, not realizing that their money is leaving their hands. They think that eventually this machine is gonna pop off and they're gonna be victorious. They don't even realize what's going on. If you have a company that provides a stock to the public, if you have a corporation that sells your bonds, if you're a financial company that deals with managing people's money, the house is the winner. They have the management fees. They make sure that they are the winner or else they go out of business. If they're not able to make that profit, they won't be hanging around. That's the way it works. You think you're winning, but it is only a matter of time before they are the ones who are doing well, and nobody else will be left standing. This is connected in with it. What debt? Companies with weak balance sheets have outperformed their sturdier peers. You could see over the last few months what has happened. Generally not a good sign, of course, but the amount of risk that people are willing to take today, this really doesn't surprise me. Then flipping over Canada, just for this quick mention of this article, the best performing sector in Canada has lost its mojo. After 8 straight months in the green, tech stocks are now on pace for their first slump this year, with about $8.3 billion in market value lost, making them the biggest losers in September. You have to understand this, okay? So this happens to be a different market than what you might be used to with Silicon Valley, with the names that typically come up, the Amazons, the Apples, and so on. Take a look at this particular company here. Shopify, okay, which I'm sure you've heard of, makes up a whopping 35% of the information technology index. That is so massive, so dangerous. All of the wealth is concentrated into such a small group, and a lot of people don't know what this is all about. They are simply just buying into whatever they're told, and as long as the stocks go up, they're happy about it. And I've seen this so many times before for people who are ignorant to reality. Equity glitch. Tech stocks in Canada are set to drop this month for the first time in 2019. And to finish off the video, I thought this was interesting. I'm not going to read the whole article, just going to mention it very quickly. Credit Suisse saga reveals ever-present bank surveillance state, which connects in with this Wall Street Journal article. He quit Credit Suisse, then he caught the bank's spy. Credit Suisse expects to reveal its findings into what went wrong on the streets of Zurich and who knew about the sleuthing. So apparently this person here had some problems internally with the company, and then they hired a private investigator to go follow the guy around. They were tapping into phone calls. They were looking into people's personal habits at these different banks. They show you some different examples in the Bloomberg article. I just thought it was crazy because if you've ever worked for some of these big establishments, you'll know what's going on. They want insight into everything that you do. It's crazy, and it's allowed to happen. In fact, human resources and the management in general definitely want to know what's going on. The corruption goes all the way to the top. It's not only accepted, it is actually promoted. I'm going to end the video there. If you found it informative, hit that thumbs up button. You got to support this channel. Free information. All you got to do is click one button. I know that's hard for too many people. This is the Amazon GPS. It is a free e-course for everybody to learn how to make money, how to build a business. So definitely check it out if you're interested at theamazongps.com. If you want the financial education you were not taught in school, these two books have everything you need from top to bottom, A to Z. You can get all the details of what you need to know historically, foundational principles, talking about interest rates and central banks and so much more. Link is in the description. If you want the audiobook, that's available at themoneygps.com. Hang on, hold on. Have you seen this video? I'm talking about nearly 9,000 stores that are closing down in the United States. 2019 numbers. Check this out. Click on it and I will see you there.